Hi, welcome to another edition of Studio 411. I'm your host, Larry Dasilva, and we're very honored today to have a terrific guest, Peter Golenbock, who's a nine-time New York Times bestselling author, widely acknowledged as one of the best oral historians in the literature of sports. You may know him for over 30 best-selling books, some of which would include The Bronx Zoo, which he co-wrote with Yankee pitcher Sparky Lyle back in the late 70s, Bums, an oral history of the Brooklyn Dodgers, Wild, High, and Tight, a biography of the late Yankee manager Billy Martin, and his latest book right here called Red Sox Nation, The Rich and Colorful History of the Boston Red Sox, which has been updated since its 2005 initial release to include, I would assume, the second and third championships in about an 11-year span. Peter, welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us.
It's my pleasure, Larry. Thanks.
Tell me about when the original idea for the book came out. The genesis was in a book you did years ago called Fenway. Did I have that correct?
You have that absolutely correct, yes.
And
I had the opportunity to interview so many former Red Sox players going back to the 20s. And that's the thrill of these books is the opportunity to talk to these former ballplayers and to save their stories, really.
And then once they won the championship in 2004, then the idea came up to then kind of bring it a little more up to date, in addition to now in 2015.
Yeah, these publishers are not stupid.
No.
Yeah. Well, you knew that the Red Sox fans had a thirst, for reading about, their victory in the World Series. And so we got it out in time for the next spring. And then, of course, they won two more World Championships. And a lot of other interesting things happened as well.
Absolutely.
In the last few years.
I know some of the new things in the book, which we'll talk about. You've got the legacy of Big Poppy, the Boston Strong, which, again, we all know based on some of the events happening in Boston. As you call it, disastrous reign of Bobby Valentine. And, of course, the additional championships. And now they seem to kind of be in kind of a little bit of a funk again, but a little wheeling and dealing on the free agent market seems to cure a lot of those ills.
Well, that funk could end very quickly with a couple of pitchers who turned out to be decent. This new kid Rodriguez, who pitched himself a shutout the other day, you need a couple of kids to come up and do well, and before you know it, the Red Sox are back in contention.
I heard Mr. Rodriguez on the news this morning going into work that he set some kind of major league record, something the first player and pitcher in major league history with at least seven strikeouts in his first three starts and while giving up no runs. Apparently no one in the history of sports. Elias Sports Bureau, of course, they stay up all hours of the night coming up with these nuggets.
Boy, I hope so.
The Red Sox Nation primarily focuses on the participants, players, coaches. You also cover a lot of the front office people and their interactions, and also many of the well-known fans throughout the decades.
Well-known and not so well-known.
Yeah.
And this last time around, I've got something like 5,000 Facebook friends, and many of them are Red Sox fans. And so I merely asked the question, tell me what you remember about X, Y, and Z. And I got a lot of those people to respond in very, very interesting ways. And I put some of their responses in the book as well.
There was a couple that stood out for me. One of the earliest, I guess, Red Sox, even though I think the team was not called the Red Sox at that point, was a descendant of the Kennedy family. There was at one point the mayor, was it Honey Fitz? Did I have that correct? That was a,
absolutely Honey Fitz.
Yeah.
Yes,
and they
yes, involved with the Royal Rooters.
The
in
Royal Rooters. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely right.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then
John
on
Kennedy's
a,
grandpa.
Yeah.
Honey Fitz.
And then on a closer to home from our area, of course, Peter is a Stamford, New Canaan native, so something I just assumed he was a New York City boy, but grew up. And of course, as I was telling the crew, I said Stamford probably was the only hospital that was open at the time, so he had to go to Stamford and then retreated to New Canaan. But it was a gentleman that was big in the Fairfield County area that I noticed had a quote in the book, a comment, has passed years ago with Tiny Markle. And I think, wow,
Tiny Markle. You knew. Yeah, I used to do his radio shows all the time.
Yeah, WNAB and WICC later on.
Yeah. WICC.
Yeah.
And he loved the Red Sox.
He was in Fairfield County. He was like a god in radio.
He was.
You know, and he used to do an early morning thing. And then later on, when you knew him, he did like a 7 to 11 or 7 to midnight and got to meet him.
I'd go see Tiny and then we'd go eat pizza.
Say again?
I'd go see Tiny and we'd have her do our show and then we'd eat pizza.
Yes, yeah. Tiny was must have been a nickname because he was a rather large man in many ways, both height and width. But he was, as I said, legendary in Connecticut circles.
Yeah.
Talk about the original team name. Again, I know from following the Yankees, of course, they were the Highlanders back in the day, but the Red Sox, it seems like they went through a couple of different names there.
They did.
Before they were, because
I can't tell you what they were.
I saw the Royal Rooters, and I saw the Royal Rooters, and then I said, oh, no, that was a...
No, the Royal Rooters were a bunch of fans.
That was a bunch of fans.
They were always, the Red Stockings, and then they became the Red Sox. I don't think there was anything in between.
Oh, I'll have to find that out. I'll have to find it. Let's see now. We got... Chick Stahl, we'll go way back.
Okay.
A gentleman that was a ball player. Seems to be a lot of suicide stories with the history of the Red Sox.
Chick Stahl, he got himself a little VD, and he gave it to his wife, and he couldn't stand, he couldn't stand the fallout, and he took some sort of, horrible poisonous something or other and committed suicide.
Wow. Again, he had been a pretty successful player back in the day, and then he was supposed to be the manager of the Sox, and then that happened.
I mean, obviously the most important person, if you want to talk about the beginnings of the Red Sox. I mean, the Red Sox, they won a whole bunch of championships in the beginning. They won more championships probably than anybody else in the American League. Babe Ruth led them as a pitcher to three of them in 1916 and 1918. Yeah.
And the previous one was in 2012. 1912, yeah, correct.
Yeah, 1912,
yeah.
Right.
Again, I think most of the folks that follow Yankee Red Sox history know, again, about, Babe Ruth and what happened there. But, again, it just... is astonishing to me that, again, people, many, of course, are not around to talk about it now, but certainly you might have met some in the early versions of this book and other research you've done. To me, just, just totally unbelievable that they would have let a guy who was the kind of ball player he was. I mean, you mentioned him as if, even to this day, he's the greatest ball player that you've ever had the chance to either... write about, research.
Well, you have
about.
To understand something. I mean, I think Barry Bonds was probably the greatest hitter who ever was in baseball history. But Babe Ruth, in addition to his 714 home runs, was the greatest pitcher, among the greatest pitchers, certainly the greatest left-handed pitcher in the American League while he was playing for the Red Sox. And the man had a fabulous, fabulous record. Won a lot of games. Helped them to three World Series and championships.
Yeah.
such an interesting guy. And what happened to the Red Sox was criminal in a way. Don't forget, the leagues, the major leagues, did not have a commissioner until 1921. After the Black Sox scandal in 1919, or until the Black Sox scandal in 1919, they had a three-person commission. And none of these people had any power over the owners. So when Harry Frazee decided he was going to sell Ruth to the Yankees, and it wasn't just Ruth, it was 12 or 13 other players as well over the next two or three years. And that's what, quite frankly, helped the Yankees to so many championships beginning in 1920. There was nobody more powerful than Colonel Rupert, who was the owner of the Yankees. None of those people, Ban Johnson or Dreyfus or any of these other people, were going to tell Colonel Rupert what he could do and what he could not do.
Right. Peter Golenbock joining us here on Studio 411. The book Red Sox Nation, The Rich and Colorful History of the Boston Red Sox, Triumph Books, and Peter joining us here for the hour. Fenway Park opened in 1912, again, as you know, later on the house that Ruth built again. What surprised me was that we think of the park and we think of things like the Green Monster and some of the bleacher seats, and there's been some more modernization done over the last decade, but the Green Monster, as I read in your book, was not even added until 1934.
No, that's correct. That's
and,
correct.
And then Tom Yawkey. Now, who did Yawkey buy the club? Because the club was in disarray, as you mentioned, by the time he came along. The club was like almost in bankruptcy. I mean, I think I got the impression the league was like almost, you know, having to do something to rectify the situation there.
But, no, it's true.
Yeah.
It's true. And the interesting thing about Yawkey, of course, was he was adopted. Yawkey was an adopted guy. His father was a very, very, very wealthy man and adopted him and died and left him millions and millions of dollars, Tom Yawkey. And several interesting things about Yawkey. During the whole time that he owned the Red Sox, which lasted into the 80s, he never won a World Series. Never did. He got into the World Series in 1948. I'm not sure he got in any other time.
He got in 46, rather.
But, yeah, 46.
Then they lost in 48, yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Some of the things I discovered in doing the research on Yawkey, a lot of the reasons they didn't win had to do with Joe Cronin, who was Clark Griffith's son-in-law, who was a star shortstop for the Washington Senators. Now, Yawkey wanted him, and Cronin was also the son-in-law of Griffith, but when Yawkey offered him $250,000, he took it. In other words, Griffith sold his son-in-law to the Red Sox.
There you go.
And he was a great shortstop. He is in the Hall of Fame. But when I asked certain pitchers about what it was like playing for Joe Cronin, they didn't like him. They didn't like him because he would call pitches from shortstop. And very often, he called fastballs more than anything else because they're not even sure why he did it. But he was a manager who kept a tight rein over his pitchers, and the pitchers really resented him for it. The other thing about Cronin, which I thought was so interesting, is that he was something of a racist. First of all, he didn't want I don't think Yawkey did either, did not want blacks on the team. Jackie Robinson and two other players tried out for the Red Sox in the mid-1940s. There was a lot of pressure going on with civil rights groups to integrate baseball. And so they had this tryout. And Robinson and a couple other really fine Negro League players went to Fenway Park to try out in front of Tom Yawkey and Joe Cronin and Eddie Collins, who was the general manager at the time. And somebody, while they were working out, one of the three of them yelled, "Get the N-word off the field." So it turned out that that tryout was really a sham, that those people had no intentions whatsoever to hire an African-American. And that was in the mid-1940s. And quite frankly, they did not hire an African-American player until 1959. And this was after teams had signed the likes of Hank Aaron, Ernie Banks, Frank Robinson, Willie Mays, Monty Irvin, Don Newcomb, Roy Campanella, certainly Jackie Robinson, who was the first. The Red Sox ended up signing a guy by the name of Pumpsy Green. And Pumpsy was a bench player.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that that was on purpose.
Oh, yeah.
And so they didn't want blacks. And according to Frank Malzone, who was somebody who I interviewed in this book, and you can read it in there, they didn't want Italians either. Jack LaMabe, I think, was the other fellow I interviewed who was Italian. And he backed up what Malzone said, that Joe Cronin wanted Irish ballplayers, did not want Italians. Yeah. It makes it hard when you limit the talent on your team. And it was one of those reasons. Their discrimination was one of the reasons why the Red Sox for so many years didn't win.
And that's also a microcosm of the society, not only throughout the country, but even
right.
In all fairness, from a historical standpoint, because even in the days of Jim Rice and other players, even in the 60s as well, Reggie Smith, I'm sure, that it was a cultural aura throughout that part of the country.
It was very difficult for a long, 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 long time, maybe perhaps until Big Poppy. African-American players did not have a good time playing in Boston. Right. That is absolutely true.
Yeah. And I think, Celtic fans, with Bill Russell and then, the Jones, as they call them, the Jones brothers, even though they weren't brothers, that was accepted, whatever. But again, it still was like,
It was funny because during the mid-60s, when I was at Dartmouth, I was the sports editor. And during those 4 years I was at college, I used to travel with my roommate, and we used to go down and watch the Celtics play, because I was a huge fan of those Celtics teams, Russell and the Jones boys and Tommy Heinsohn and all those guys, Havlicek, and they never had a full house. They rarely had very good attendance.
Yeah.
And I suspect a large part of that was because there were so many African-American players on that ball club.
Yeah, I mean, there's a point that, again, no one really knew about it. I mean, you've just educated me on that point because, here it is, umpteen championships, took years until Phil Jackson broke Red Auerbach's record, and he would have had another one if it wasn't that he stepped aside for Bill Russell to be the player coach.
That's right.
Even then, and you wonder, I don't think he would ever admit it, but I think even Russell's time as a coach was short-lived there. Frankly, probably A, didn't care for it as much, and B, maybe the environment was also not in his favor as well.
Also, it's extremely difficult for star players to be the coach. I mean, when Ted Williams was the manager of the Washington Senators, and then I think he did 1 year when they moved to Texas.
Right.
He just had a real tough time of it. He couldn't understand why his players couldn't do what he could do. And I think that becomes a real serious problem for all the great ball players. It just becomes very, very hard to coach because you can't understand why these guys, can't do what you want them to do.
I think, Frank Robinson had some success, again, to digress. But again, my favorite memory of him was one time watching a Met game. This might have been in the 80s when he was managing the Giants. And I want to say, I don't think it was Jim Willoughby. I'm trying to remember. It was a tall player that was like a starter for them. And
okay.
Robinson didn't like that the pitcher was walking off the mound before he got to the mound. He grabbed them by the neck and literally, and Frank was about, 6'4", or whatever, he might have been even taller.
Oh, yeah.
And literally, hoisted him back on the mound, like to say, you don't leave until I get here.
Frank had a wicked temper.
Yeah.
He did, and you didn't want to mess with him.
Yeah.
It was absolutely true.
But he did have some success, but again, it was tempered. And as you said, there are players like Hank Aaron, Willie Mays, Yastrzemski, people like that. Again, they just wasn't in their blood, whereas The other thing, too, and we're talking with Peter Golenbock joining us on Studio 411, Red Sox Nation, the rich and colorful history of the Boston Red Sox. I think I knew it, but your book highlighted it even more for me. We forget that throughout the many decades of Red Sox history, there's a lot of intermingling, is the word I came up with, of Yankee and Red Sox, not even so much players, there's some great ones, but managers. You know, Joe McCarthy, I had forgotten, managed the Red Sox and then left, and actually probably left them in bad shape from a leadership standpoint. And right now I'm blanking on a few others. Ralph Houk was another one.
That's true.
He went to the Tigers and then later Red Sox. But again, there were several others there. Bucky Harris, wasn't he a manager? Or am I mistaken?
Bucky Harris in 1947 and 48 was the manager before Casey Stengel.
Right. And there were one or two others. And it was just like amazing that. But it always seemed like that the Red Sox were kind of picking them kind of after they were done with the Yankees.
Well, with McCarthy especially. McCarthy had fallen drunk in the gutter in 1944 or 45, something like that, and he was out for good 3 weeks while he was trying to dry out. And after the I think it was the 45 season in New York, they let him go. They let him go in the middle of the season, and Bill Dickey took over for a little while, and Dickey didn't have the temperament to do it either. And then Bob Shawkey took over, and finally they brought in Bucky Harris in 1947, and he wasn't the guy Topping and Webb wanted either. They had made George Weiss, we're talking about the Yankees now.
Yes.
They had made George Weiss the general manager of the team, and Weiss very well knew that the best manager that he could possibly find was Casey Stengel. And Stengel had never won anything.
But he was having some success in the minors in Oakland, California.
He had managed in Brooklyn to some desultory teams and the Boston Braves. Not anything very good. But of course, you know what happened when he came up to the Yankees in 49. He almost never lost. Won 8 out of 10.
He did know how to push the buttons, but I also think you brought it up was, I think, the management team there, to digress from the Red Sox for a moment. I think they kind of figured, well, we can control this guy. You know, we just kind of like let the players do their thing. And then gradually as the years went on, and of course you rack up 3, 4, 5 championships, you're going to start, you know, flexing your muscles a little bit until they used the excuse in 1960. Well, you know, he's getting old.
He was 70.
Yeah, but Mazeroski, you know, did them in. I mean, Mantle, Richardson, all those players, I think that was...
I think the problem with the Red Sox, more than anything, is that Yawkey wanted drinking buddies. That was more important even than winning pennants, I think.
Right.
I mean, his fealty to Joe Cronin was, to me, bizarre. You know? You didn't have to be a rocket science to see that, you know, comparing Joe Cronin, for instance, to George Weiss, the Red Sox fell, you know, way behind as a result of that. But Yawkey didn't seem to care. Cronin was like a son to him, and he kept him on and on and on and on until he finally became the commissioner of the American League.
Yawkey, I'm sure, did some good things. I know in the early 30s, he flexed some cash and whatever, so they brought in like Lefty Grove, Wes Farrell, Jimmy
That's
Fox,
right.
whatever. That was, you know, the first kind
of... Well, they came close. They came pretty close. But Jimmy Fox was a Red Sox for a little while.
Yeah, yeah, and unfortunately, which I learned from your book, I didn't know he had gotten hit... 42, I think it was, had gotten hit with a pitch and then started stepping in the bucket and then couldn't function. And of course he had his, you know, drinking problems as well. But something you brought up, would you say something that I think all of us might be able to relate to? Yawkey, in his own way, was kind of like the Leon Hess of baseball. In other words, he loved his team. But instead of being maybe a little more like Steinbrenner and like saying, look, I want this and I want it now, he just, as you said, did a few things and then was just content to just own the ball club.
Well, I mean, I think he was trying as hard as he could. But, you know, if you look at the success of a team, you have to look at the guy who owns it. You know, there's a tremendous connection there. You have to have the funds and you have to have the will. You know, you have to want to win. In other words, if you're going 2 or 3 years and you're not winning under a certain, you know, group of guys, you say to yourself, I've got to get rid of these guys and get new guys.
Right.
Well, Yawkey never did that.
Yeah.
Yawkey apparently was satisfied with the people he had working for him. And they just, you know, went along year after year after year after year.
Yeah, and we had talked about this off air a few weeks ago, is that there is a happy medium, I believe, between the way you and I talked about, like, the Steinbrenner years, especially the early years, where, you know, you could be the ball boy and be in fear of your job, you know, and then, of course, the Yawkey.
They were all in fear of their job.
There's like
the weird thing about Steinbrenner is that the only time the Yankees ever won was right after he was given a sentence of life, a life sentence, for whatever, you know, misdeed that he did.
The
first time it was for Watergate.
Yeah, and then the Dave Winfield.
Those 2 years, Gabe Paul put the club together, and then they started to win in 75, 76, 77, yeah. 78. And then the second time was after he paid Howie Spira $40,000 for information on Dave Winfield, and they put him away for 2 years, and at that time, Stick Michael managed to keep all those young kids, who I guarantee you, Steinbrenner would have traded them all away. He'd have traded Derek Jeter away. He'd have traded Jorge Posada or Bernie Williams. He'd have traded Andy Pettit. He'd have traded Mariano Rivera. Mariano Rivera, when George was there, was a starter, and he didn't have very much control, and George was talking about trading him.
I had heard that.
He went away for a couple of years, yeah. And before you know it, after those 2 years, he becomes a star. The other guys become stars, and they won a bunch of pennants in World Series. The rest of the time, the other 26 years, George's teams never won because he always traded away the young kids and got, you know, veterans who were over the hill.
Yeah, give a plug to the book. I don't have it written here, but
there it is. You, Red Sox Nation.
No, that one as well. Here, I'm holding up my copy as well. But no, you did a book on Steinbrenner. What reminds
George? Called George.
George, yeah.
And, George. And if you want to read a really salacious book about Mickey Mantle, read my book 7.
There you go.
The number 7. Yes.
Yeah. No, it's great.
About
great
Mickey's
stuff.
Sex life.
Yeah. Oh, gee. What'd you think about the one, Ms. Levy wrote a few years ago of Mickey?
It's a wonderful book.
Yeah.
She's a very, very talented, wonderful writer.
I know, listening to Mike Francesa, of course, like yourself, even more so, the ultimate Yankee Mickey Mantle fan, and she just, you know, he just loved, you know, talking about her and the book. Back to the Red Sox. I was stunned that, again, until Mr. Yawkey came along in the early 30s, and I think this was even into the late 30s, the Red Sox had no farm system.
Nobody did.
So
nobody had a farm system. You know who started the farm system?
I thought it was
Brantricki.
I was going to say Brantricki.
Brantricki
started
the farm system with the St. Louis Cardinals.
Yeah.
He was the smartest man. Brantricki was the most important singular non-baseball player, I would say, in the history of baseball. The guy was absolutely amazing in everything that he did, where he started the farm system with the Cardinals. He had been with the St. Louis Browns. The stupidest thing the Browns ever did was let him go.
I am still amazed. I know it was the war years that the Browns actually won a pennant. I could never figure out that.
The Browns won the pennant. They did.
Yeah, didn't they have Vern Stevens, who later played for the Sox? I think he was their MVP that year.
I'll tell you, that one of the other books that I wrote called The Spirit of St. Louis, which is about the Cardinals and the Browns. The Browns really had some incredibly interesting people. And winning the pennant that year, it was a bunch of drunks and a bunch of real hard-nosed characters who played on that team. And you read what those guys had to say. It was really delightful what those Browns guys had to say. The next year, they had a one-armed outfielder by the name of Pete Gray.
You just read my mind. I was going to say.
What was interesting in interviewing those guys, the other guys, about Gray, they hated him. They just hated this guy because he had no talent. He had, I think, like 219. And they felt that he was being played only for the value of bringing in the fans, which he didn't bring many fans in. I think they drew, you know, 4,000 people a game for the entire schedule.
Wow.
But the players used to do everything they could to really, you know, anger Pete Gray. He used to wear one of those straw hats and they would grab the hat and punch the end of it out, put it back on his head. One time they took a dead fish and they stuck it in his jacket. You know, as they did everything they could to harass this poor guy.
Fun and hijinks at the major league level.
That's right.
back in the 40s. I was going to say, I think the Red Sox might have taken Mr. Gray ahead of Pumpsy if they were still playing around the same time.
That's probably true. I suspect that's true.
Because yes. I know the Yankees took a lot of heat for like waiting until Elston Howard, and it was.
Well, you can take a lot of heat when you're winning championship after championship. You can. Now, the interesting thing is Elston Howard turned out to be a marvelous, marvelous player.
Absolutely.
He ended up being the MVP of the American League in 1964. But George Weiss was a racist as well. He didn't want black players because he thought that black fans would drive the white fans out. I mean, everybody did. When Branch Rickey brought Jackie Robinson up to the Dodgers in 1947, the owners had taken a poll, a vote. They had taken a vote, and the vote was 15-1. Against bringing him up. And the unknown hero in this little play was Happy Chandler, who was the commissioner. Chandler had been the governor of Kentucky. He was a U.S. senator from Kentucky. And yet, he said to Ricky, if I die and I go to heaven, I'm not going to say to God, I was the one who kept the African Americans from playing.
Right.
So he's the unsung hero of this whole thing when Robinson came up.
I had a chance some 30 years ago, a radio sports talk show that I produced, had a chance to pre-interview and then get Happy Chandler on the program with the host that we had. And marvelous man. He had stories to tell that were just unbelievable.
He was. And then when his contract ran out, all those owners kicked him out.
Yeah. Oh yeah, there's an idea for
that. Because of that.
There's an idea for a book. See, I have a book on Happy Chandler. I'm sure one's been written, but I think you'd do a fantastic job. Speaking of Elston, of course, now moving forward to jumping around a little bit in the '67 impossible dream year.
Yes.
Late in the year, Elston gets traded when they have a need for a real catcher. You know, a solid catcher. His best years are behind him, but he winds up playing almost a year and a half with the Red Sox and distinguishes himself even in the World Series a little bit.
Without a doubt. No, yeah. He was a great, great player and a great, great person.
Yeah, left way too soon. Yeah.
I adored him. He was a lovely man. He had an enlarged heart, though, and he died at a very young age.
Yeah, absolutely. Speaking of catchers, we were talking the other day, you'll correct me if I have it wrong, that I heard that Yogi is, who's at least 90 or approaching 90,
Yogi's 90,
is getting, I think, a Congressional Medal of Honor that for a service. I think he'll be the 11th ex-ball player for years, primarily World War II years, to get the recognition. So,
did you know that Yogi was on D-Day? Yogi landed on the beach at D-Day.
Amazing.
I know.
I don't know.
One of the most wonderful, wonderful people. And they made fun of him because they said he was ugly. They said he was stupid. Let me tell you something. He was the smartest one of them all. He saved his first nickel. Everything he ever touched went to gold. Yogi Berra drinks Yoo-Hoo, made a fortune with Yoo-Hoo stock. He owned a giant mansion in Montclair, New Jersey. He had the most beautiful wife. He had four wonderful kids. Meanwhile, all his buddies, Billy Martin, Mickey Mantle, and the rest of them, all were broke.
Yeah. No, smart is witticisms, whatever. I mean, there's been books written about them and just, a classic guy. And, he had success everywhere he went.
Let me tell you something else which people forget. He not only led the 1964 Yankees as the manager to the championship, to the pennant at any rate, but he also led the Mets in 1973 to a championship.
And in both cases, came down to Game 7 and, a little break here and there. But, tremendous. Just didn't like harmonicas, but I guess he made up later.
He did not like harmonicas.
He made up later. It's a little hard.
Phil Innes told me about that story. Yeah. He said he was tootling on the harmonica, and Yogi told him to put it away. And so Lynn said to Joe Pepitone, what did he say? And Pepitone said to him, play it louder.
Yeah. Yeah, Pepe was, I would love to interview Pepe. He's got... quite a few stories, I'm sure, to tell. And actually, Rizzuto, fellow Italian as Pepitone is and continues to be, I believe. A book written on him, like, you know, Joe, you could have made us proud because he was like a four-tool player.
That was a wonderful book, by the way. Yeah. Did you read his book?
Excerpt. Did you write that one too?
No. I loved it. No, I didn't write that one.
Another guy, and I forget
but
if
he
I...
he is in Dynasty.
I'm sorry?
He is in Dynasty.
Yes, yes.
And by the way, you can buy every one of these books. They still all exist in every single form. You can buy them in book form. You can buy them in audio form. You can buy them in ebook form. All these books still exist. They're still around.
Technology is a great thing for the Golenbock family.
It is. It certainly is.
And I'll just comment for the viewers. I love the montage. Your writer's cave, we'll call it, and it just he gave me a little tour. We won't do that, but to Peter's left, he's got marvelous plates. I see a Thurman Munson to Peter's right. I don't know if that's a George Bush hanging in effigy behind
George
us.
George Bush pants on fire.
Oh my goodness! I didn't know if it was George or Jeb. Anyway, one or the other.
That's George W.
Peter Golenbock joining us for the hour on Studio 411, Red Sox Nation, the rich and colorful history of the Boston Red Sox. Going back to the late 40s, 50s, when the Red Sox kind of had another run, 46 World Series we talked about. Story that I did not know about, Enos Slaughter, of course, the mad dash from first base.
Yep.
There had been a change. I don't know if it was a defensive change or whether it was due to injury, but the player that we would have thought would have been in center field, was I correct, it was not Dom DiMaggio?
No, it was not Dom DiMaggio.
And
it was somebody else.
And that's why that...
That's right.
And also Mr. Pesky, if I have my players correct.
He was the one who supposedly held the ball, but he swears to this day, if he were still alive, he would tell you that that's not what happened.
I've seen the clip, and again, I don't presume to say, okay, you were right, you were wrong, but it did look like there was either some uncertainty there, or in his opinion, he just thought that the player was going to score and not to, at that point, what have you got to lose? They should have thrown the ball. So,
you'll have to take it up with Johnny.
Yes, but he's not on top of the pesky pole right now.
He is.
Yes.
He is not with us. But another one of these fabulous, fabulous characters.
Oh, marvelous.
The joy of writing these books is meeting these people. Pesky was wonderful. Ted Williams, of course, was fantastic. Just so many of these guys.
That group that I was going to mention from the 40s and throughout a big part of the 50s. Again, Williams, you mentioned. The Professor, Dom DiMaggio, Bobby Doerr, Johnny Pesky. There are some that say Pesky should be in the Hall of Fame. I guess that's open to debate. But still, that is I would say, about as core four Red Sox that you could ask for. I mean, I don't know recent vintage if they've had a core four quite like that.
Was it David Halberstam who wrote the book Teammates about Ted Williams? And Pesky and Doerr, I think it was.
I believe, before he passed, yeah.
Red Sox fans, that's a great book to read. Yeah.
But, more recent vintage, and again, I'm counting like non-pitchers, because again, the Yankees, Red Sox have had quite a few, outstanding pitchers, Mel Parnell, Jim Lonborg, again, but usually in short stints, not Hall of Fame necessarily careers.
Jim Lonborg never should have gone skiing.
Yes, I know. And I think the Red Sox gave up on him too soon because he went on to have a few productive years with the Phillies. Would you say the 50s for the Red Sox then, probably from the mid-50s for about a 10-year span? I mean, that was really kind of a lean period for them.
It was lean.
Yeah, I mean.
It certainly was lean. My college roommate, Rich Hershenson, his favorite player was Don Budden.
Yeah.
During the 50s. He was the shortstop for the Red Sox. His nickname was Bootin' Budden. That sort of tells you about the Red Sox in the 50s.
Well, they also had a marvelous player, Jackie Jensen, who then wound up actually retiring early. I don't even know how he could play a game because he had a fear of flying.
He did. Jensen started out coming up with Mickey Mantle with the Yankees.
Yeah.
And he went to, from the Yankees, he went to the Washington Senators in a trade for Irvin. Which Irvin? Not Monty, the other Irvin.
No, the other Irvin, yeah.
The other Irvin.
Another one. The Yankees used to just toss away prospects, probably they did later. Lou Burdette was a Yankee, or in the farm system.
Lou Burdette absolutely was a Yankee.
And then
wound
up going.
Do you know how many catchers were sitting behind Yogi Berra during all those years? Yogi played for 20 something years, and all those catchers they signed who came up behind him all ended up Sherm Lawler. There's so many of them who ended up on other teams.
Yeah. And then,
because you're not going to replace Yogi.
Ralph Houck, he had a permanent seat on the bullpen.
World Series, after World Series ring, probably didn't play 10 games a year.
I recall, and I don't know why, I think it was just you spoke very enthusiastically about him. For those who I'm sure say, oh, Peter, he looks familiar. Well, Yankeeography, so many of those MLB-type shows, Peter has been a contributor to those for years. But I remember you talking about probably the 61 season with the Yankees, again, digressing from the Red Sox, but your just enthusiasm of John Blanchard. You just loved or had nothing but praise for that guy as a third-string catcher, which is hard to do.
Well, he was a guy he could catch. He would also play the outfield a little bit. In a reserve role, he had 20, 21 home runs in 1961. And, you know, the joy of interviewing these people is to find out how much they loved baseball, how they loved being a major leaguer, how they loved, in this case, being a New York Yankee. And these are people who were making probably, I don't know, $18,000 a year, $24,000 a year. These people were not getting rich. Mickey was making $100,000. Mm-hmm. Ted Williams was making $100,000. But the rest of them weren't getting rich, especially during that period of time.
It was like the old quote in the early to mid Steinbrenner years when they would ask Mickey, and I'm sure the same would be true of Yastrzemski and some of these great ball players, Willie Mays, but was something along the lines, I'm paraphrasing, Mickey, what would you be making like, you know, in today's day? And Mickey had some remark like, well, you know, he'd probably be like, you know, part owner because, you know, they couldn't afford to pay. I mean, they talk about your Bryce Harper and Mr. Trout out in California and some of these players, though, they all want to compare to Mantle. And guess what?
Sure.
No one is Josh Hamilton to a certain degree, but unfortunately he's got a lot of...
The difference is, of course, is that Mickey played for 20-something years and Josh Hamilton had two good ones.
Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, I mean, that's really the difference.
But we're always...
During those years where there was Ted Williams and Mickey Mantle and Willie Mays and Duke Snyder, I mean, you know, that was the heart of that generation.
Yeah. Speaking of Duke Snyder, I'm reminded of a player you mentioned earlier that, again, I did not know until I read Red Sox Nation by our guest Peter Golenbock. The Red Sox, amongst all the names you mentioned, they passed on Pee Wee Reese.
Well, they had Pee Wee Reese. And this is another Joe Cronin story. Pee Wee Reese was a shortstop, and everybody knew he was a superstar. Cronin, so that Reese wouldn't take his job, sold him to the Brooklyn Dodgers.
So in theory, with that bit of information that I learned from your book, the Red Sox could have had an infield that would have comprised of Pee Wee at short, Jackie, wherever you wanted to play him, had they had the brains to or the guts to stand out like Ricky and the Dodgers did, and then it makes you wonder who else again. You know, Willie Mays, people like that.
He could have had Willie Mays, absolutely.
But meanwhile,
don't forget Willie was playing in Birmingham.
Yeah.
The Red Sox minor league team was in Birmingham. It couldn't have been that difficult to realize that Willie Mays was one of the greatest players who ever was going to play.
Yeah.
You had to be stupid.
But meanwhile, with all due respect to Mr. Green, we wind up with Pumpsy.
Well, you did. I know.
The 60s came along. You mentioned Frank Malzone. Again, you had a young Yastrzemski. I was surprised to realize that Yaz and Ted Williams, even though, again, it was kind of like a DiMaggio-Mantle thing,
Right.
Did not necessarily get along. Was that, again, because of a position? No,
it's because of the personalities of the two guys.
Yeah.
Ted was somebody who had a lot of opinions, and his opinions weren't always kind. And Yaz was sort of he was not a particularly genial guy himself.
Right.
And it's over the years, you don't see much of Yaz. You know, they'll bring him out and he'll wave every once in a while, but you don't see, interviews with him or he doesn't want to be bothered.
Yeah.
He's not somebody who cares about the press or publicity or any of that sort of stuff.
You made a comment.
They were just two great players, is what they were.
Absolutely. You made a comment to me when we spoke a few weeks ago, and again, I know that it is 30 years since Yaz retired, much less at his peak.
But where did those 30 years go, by the
way? I know. I was lining up Happy Chandler and the Farrell brothers and all these great guests. Dave McNally.
I went to see Secretariat run at the Belmont in 1973.
Yeah.
Somebody said to me, "Do you know how many years ago that was?"
I remember that. The horse just kept pulling away. It was one of the greatest. I think this horse that just won in 2015, as we tape, was... I think only Secretariat's time was slightly better than American Pharoah. No,
isn't
no
that
one else.
Fantastic.
And
all I know is, after Secretariat crossed that line, it was 31 more lengths before the next horse finally showed up.
Yeah, the one that was supposed to be the threat because of the speed in this latest Derby or Belmont rather. Finished dead last. I don't even remember the horse's name now, but it was supposed to be the winner. In the last 20 years, again, take us through, again, what did the Red Sox finally do right other than besides hiring Terry Francona? What factors played into finally this?
In the last 10 years?
But even a few years before that, because as you well know, even with the Yankees,
they won in 67 because Karyashensky had just had a magnificent year,
and Lomborg had a career
and
year.
The dentist Lomborg, had won 20 something games, and that was just fantastic. They didn't win in 1978, and nobody ever wants to talk about that. If you live in New England, if you live north of Hartford. You don't want to be mentioning the name of Bucky Dent.
No,
it's just not a very, very good idea.
I met Bucky a couple of years ago with Jim Rice at an event. Of course, everybody's all chummy now, whatever. But bleeping Dent is
Well, I mean, there were three of them. There was Bucky bleeping Dent. There was Billy bleeping Buckner, and there was the Adam bleeping Boone. Effing, not bleeping, but effing Boone. There were three of them.
But with Bill.
You know, when I was with the St. Petersburg Pelicans in 1990, this was in the senior league. Jim Rice played on the Pelicans in the second year.
Wow.
And I was the color guy on the radio. And it was about the second game of the season, and I went and said, "Mr. Rice, I'm so-and-so. I'm the color guy on the radio. Can I ask you a few questions?" He looks at me and goes, "No." He walks off.
Wow.
He was as nasty as you could possibly be.
So he was. He was
turn around and find out that he's one of the announcers on the Red Sox. I just couldn't believe it.
Yeah. Oh yeah. He was in that same mold, maybe a tad spicier as Williams Yastrzemski. Not very much into talking with the media.
It was more on the George Hendricks.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not talking to anybody ever.
Or Steve Carlton. Yeah.
Steve Carlton. Right. Carlton was the other one. Right.
In our remaining moments with Peter Golenbock, again, you've done so much work with so many different teams and compiled stuff, but just during your lifetime, again, we'll go quickly by position, in your opinion. We'll start with catcher. In your era, greatest Red Sox catcher, not just the last 10 years, that you said that you had the privilege to see.
Oh, Carlton Fisk.
Okay, first base.
Um,
That's not, you know, George Scott, or would you say?
Yeah, well, there was somebody better than that. He was with the team a couple of years only, though.
Oh, Menkevich? No, no.
No.
Oh.
That's funny. First baseman, it's Jimmy Fox. You come up with Fox.
Jimmy Fox, okay. All right.
Yeah, look at Fox.
Second base.
The guy they got right now, who I love. He's just a fabulous player.
That's high praise, considering some of the folks that have come along before.
This guy is just tremendous.
Shortstop.
They traded him just before they won the championship in 2004. He was the best that I saw.
So over Pesky. Yeah, I'm blanking.
Yeah,
on
no, this is. Guy, this guy was fantastic. He was the star of the Red Sox for 4 or 5 years. I'm just drawing a blank.
Yeah, you remember
asking me these questions.
You remember what team he went to?
I
me stumped. All right, well, we'll
but
get.
But you know, they traded him. They brought some other guy, and the other guy helped him win the pennant in 2004. He was hurt.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're supposed to know these things.
I know. I don't know that one. I should. I'm going to think of it about 2 a.m. in the morning. Third base.
Third base. I always love Malzone, of course.
Petrucelli.
Petrucelli would be another one of the shortstops, without a doubt.
Mike Lowell.
Not
there long
wonderful.
Enough.
I love all these people, but there's only one great one. Yeah. Malzone was one of the very, very best.
And then if you had a pick during your lifetime, top three outfield.
Pye Trainer played in the teens.
Yeah.
See, he's not in my lifetime.
No, I hope not.
That was something of a joke. Yastrzemski, you got to put Big Poppy somewhere, for crying out loud.
A DH.
Third guy that I put up there would be Tony Cnigliaro. Cnigliaro was going to be an all-star. He was going to be in the Hall of Fame. He was going to be everything. And one of the worst things that ever happened to the Red Sox was when he got hit in the eye and just about ended his career. It's terrible.
Did you get a chance to ever speak with him before he passed, or no?
No, I did not.
Again, I saw an image not long ago. It was an old Sports Illustrated. And this, of course, was a few days after, you know, the beaning. But when they were carrying him out on the stretcher, I mean, his face was already, like, almost unrecognizable.
Oh, no, it was terrible. He hit him right in the eye. Yeah. I mean, literally hit him right in the eye.
He got hit by, at that time, I believe, California Angels pitcher Jack Hamilton, who used to play for the Mets prior to that. And Hamilton claims it was not a, you know, a doctored pitch. It was nothing intentional.
No, I don't think it was either. He hung over the plate. He got hit a lot.
Yeah.
He hung over the plate because he could then take, you know, an outside pitch and pull it. And he threw Hamilton through sidearm and let go in a funny spot. And the thing just, rather than going towards the mitt, went, you know, up and away and just nailed him right in the face.
Peter Golenbock, the book Red Sox Nation, updated 2015, The Rich and Colorful History of the Boston Red Sox.
You didn't talk about my Stamford, Connecticut buddy, Bobby Valentine.
Oh, Bobby Valentine. No.
We'll
cover that. We've been trying to get Bobby on the show, but
easy getting a hold of Bobby.
There you go. Well, now
Bobby's
now
not
I have
easy an, to get a hold
he, he's given me all sorts of connections, but unfortunately we've run out of time. The book is by Triumph Books. Again, it's a tremendous, tremendous book. And this is a tremendous gentleman. We thank you so much for joining us. And we're going to try to get him and his other buddy, Marty Appel, on the program together. That would be quite a conversation. I would hardly have to speak. So
Marty was responsible for my career.
That's right. That's right. To be continued, my friend.
Okay.
We'll be talking again next time when we meet on Studio 411. Larry Dasilva, thanking you for joining us, thanking Peter Golenbock, and we wish you the best, and we will talk to you again soon. Thanks.
Take care.